Thank you very much. At first, I would like to thank to the organizing committee for possibility giving me to present some of our results, which we obtain in our laser laboratory called PALS. So this picture shows a view into our laser laboratory. Here at the left side is an oscillator table, which where is oscillator producing very, very short laser pulses, which are then amplified by a five power amplifiers up to energy higher than 1 kilojoule. Then, because this laser system belongs to the kilojoule class lasers, it was included in a book devoted to the fusion physics, which was issued 7 years ago by International Atomic Energy Agency in Vienna, into laser system, which are able to study experimental study of laser fusion. Our laser system was built up in the Max Planck Institute for Plasma Physics in Garching near Munich in Germany about 25 years ago, and 20 years ago was removed into the Institute of Plasma Physics and our Institute of Physics in Prague, and from the year 2000 is operated as a laser system, Prague Asterix laser system. So when the nanosecond laser pulse with energy up to 1 kilojoule is generated, then it is focused onto the target in an interaction chamber, the diameter of which is 1 meter. Here you can see a lens holder, and the focal lens, focal length of this lens is about 600 millimeters. So this laser system is operated at the wavelength of 1.3 micrometers. The duration is about 400 picoseconds. It is full width at a half maximum. The laser energy which we can focus onto the target is not 1 kilojoule due to losses on optical systems, but up to 800 joules, and resulting intensity on the target is about 5 times 10 to 16 watt per square centimeters. So it is a shadow graph of a plasma produced by our laser system. And here you can see a detail of the target, which is irradiated with a laser pulse, which generates a plasma. The plasma is not a simple object. His shape is very, very complex. And the plasma is source of electrons, fast ions, soft X-rays, gamma rays, electromagnetic pulses, and when we irradiate a target containing deuterium, it can be source also of fusion neutrons. So this target is at the end of this interaction chamber. Within the target chamber are located various detectors, for example, ion collectors, ion analyzers, electron spectrometers, X-ray spectrometers, and if neutrons are generated, then we use scintillation detectors, which are localized outside the interaction chamber. So, at first, I would like to mention a phenomenon which accompanies the expansion of the laser plasma. It is a target current, which is also a source of, or generator of electromagnetic pulses. This observation of this target current allowed us to determine various phases of the laser produced plasma. Then I will speak about generation of hot or relativistic electrons, fast ions, and finally I will present some results with fusion of deuterons, fusion of deuteron and lithium, and generation of alpha particles through the fusion of proton and boron 11. So when the target is exposed to the laser radiation, at first fast electrons are able to escape the plasma, and this shortage of electrons within the plasma causes that the target is positively charged, but the target is through the holder grounded, and the shortage of this electrons is substituted by electrons flowing from the ground to the target holder and into the plasma. It is a general process because it is a process which leads to the occurrence of a double layer plasma, which means that the process of charge separation happens. When we integrate this target current, we obtain exactly exact number of electrons escaped the plasma. If the target current is low, it is possible to use a resistive target probe, but when the amplitude of target current is very high, for example, a few kiloamps, the use of a resistive target is not suitable, and it is better to use an inductive probe. So here you can see a photo of our inductive probe for measurement of kiloamps target current. Here it is all holder, up is target holder, and below it is target probe. And here is a wire which connect the target holder with the ground, and as electrons are flowing through this wire, they generate magnetic field, and we measure this magnetic field with a loop, such a loop, very small loop antenna, which has diameter of about 5 millimeters. So in fact we measure signal on the loop, and it is proportional to the time derivative of the target current after it as shows this inset, and after the integration we obtain the target current which neutralized the positive charge of the plasma during its expansion. The duration of the target current is very long. It is much longer than the duration of the laser pulse, or much longer than the interaction of the laser pulse with plasma, because the plasma survives for a very long time. As shows, for example, this X-ray photo or picture of the plasma, which was obtained or made about 5 nanoseconds after the laser plasma interaction. And here you can see, for this given sensitivity of our camera, borders of the laser produced plasma from which the fastest electrons escaped. Here is a very simple diagram how it is works. This graph represents the distribution, energy distribution function of electrons. Here is energy which is related to the potential barrier of the plasma, and when electrons has higher energy than this potential barrier, they are able to escape the plasma. But because the plasma is grounded via the target holder, the earth delivers cold electrons into the plasma. So this mechanism is responsible for the generational creation of at least two temperature plasma. Two temperature plasma because this hot electrons from the tail of the distribution function create substanding electron cloud with very high temperature, for example, 100 kiloelectron volts. But the electrons remaining in this lower part of the electron distribution function are much colder. For example, they have a temperature of 10 kiloelectron volts. This picture shows a comparison of the target current with laser pulse intensity, which was measured with an optical streak camera. This red line represents the power of the laser system. It means it is in watt. And it is compared with the time derivative of the target current. So we can see that the derivative of the target current is proportional to the laser intensity. And oppositely, when we integrate the laser power, we obtain the increase of the laser energy which was impacted onto the target. It is here. And this laser energy drives the target current. But after the 1 nanosecond, laser interaction is at the end. But the plasma exists for a longer time. So we can say that we have here two phases in the development of the plasma, laser-produced plasma. The first is plasma ignition phase. It means the time when the plasma is driven by the laser pulse. And then is substanding phase, plasma active phase. It is active because it is permanently source of electrons, ions, X-rays, etc. Here is another case where when we expose a copper target with very low intensity. It is intensity of 600 millijoules, not of 600 joules, but millijoules. It is comparable with tabletop laser systems, which are used for diagnostic of targets, etc. And in this case, the active phase duration was 1 microsecond. It's very, very long time. But after this time, we observed the current of electrons going from the target to the ground. And it is because the plasma is filled, the target chamber is filled of a plasma which is not accelerated. It is a residual ionized gas or material remaining in the plasma. And in the case the target holder acts as a general plasma probe and detects electrons coming from this plasma, and we can see that the duration of this plasma is 5 microseconds. Here is an example of two target currents. The red one is related to the current from a polyethylene, it is isolator, and from graphite. Here we can see that the main peak duration is about 10 nanosecond. When we integrate this target current, we are able to say that, or found, that during the first nanosecond, the total number of electrons needed for neutralization of the target is about 4 × 10⁻³ electrons. But in the next 9 nanoseconds, this amount is increased up to 2 × 10⁴. It means that it is a number of electrons which are able or which were able to escape the plasma during its expansion into the vacuum chamber. Of course, in the front of these electrons escaping the plasma are the very fast electrons which we detected or analyzed the energy with use of an electron energy spectrometer, which is based on the use of magnetic field created with a double pole. It's a double pole magnet. Electrons are declinated from the path and irradiate imaging plates. Here is a strip of imaging plates, and the blackening is proportional to the number of electrons hitting these detectors. Here is a view into the interaction chamber. Here is a target holder, target, and around it was about 12, 14 spectrometers. So we are able to observe the angular distribution of electrons emitted in the backward direction, it means against the laser path, or in the forward direction, it means from the rear side of the target, if it is not too thick. These spectra were obtained when we irradiated very thin molybdenum foil. The thickness was 6 micrometers, and the maximum energy of hot electrons was 1 mega electron volts. I have to say that the rest residual energy of electrons is 511 kilo electron volts. So this part of electrons spectra belong to the relativistic electrons. When we irradiated a polyethylene target, which was thick of half millimeter, we observed electrons with maximum energy up to 5 mega electron volts. Problem or interesting here is the variable Lorentz factor, which represents the kinetic energy versus the energy of light of velocity of electrons to the velocity of the light. Here is this line, is a Maxwell-Yuttner distribution function. It is a general function which is valid for each type of particles. However, in our case, this Maxwell-Yuttner distribution function was not applicable to our distributions. The analysis was made with the use of Gaussian functions. It is the shape of the Maxwell-Yuttner distribution function. Here is the formula for the Lorentz factor. Theta is the temperature, etc. But 10 years ago, Dr. Sherlock published a paper where he inform us that electron distribution function cannot be also observed or described with Maxwell-Yuttner distribution function, but with the use of a shifted Gaussian function. It is valid also in our case, and this effect is related to the problem that when the electron distribution function is not dependent only on the temperature, on eventually center of mass energy of the expanding plasma, then the distribution function became a shape of normal distribution, it means Gaussian distribution. But from these peaks, we were able to estimate the temperature of electrons. And this picture shows the temperature of electrons produced in our laboratory, which are the results. Of course, it is out of all known dependencies. We can compare our results, for example, with theoretical results, which were obtained for femtosecond laser pulses where the electrons are accelerated due to the relativistic interactions. And for this comparison, we can say that it will be possible only if the intensity on the target would be increased by a factor of 10. It means that the focus diameter should be shrinked from 70 micrometers to the value of 7 micrometers. Similar results we observed in the case of fast ions. We measured the fast ions with the use of ion collectors or eventually with semiconductor detectors, because semiconductor detectors are very sensitive to the, only sensitive to the kinetic energy of ions. And when this front surface of this detector is screened with aluminum foil, which is able to absorb also of X-rays and so on, then we obtain very, very nice signal, which starts here at energy of 4.2 mega electron volts. It is energy of protons, which are on the first line in the front of expansion ions. And it is time of flight, of ions for the distance from the target of 1 millimeter. So here also we can see that our laser system generated 4 mega electron volt protons. This experiment was repeated several times, and also it is a picture which enable us to compare various laser systems. Here is results from femtosecond laser lasers interactions, and this maximum proton energy is proportional to the intensity of laser. And here is a geometrical factor he, which represents the quality of the laser pulse. When this function is fitted to this experimental data, we obtain the fitted value of this parameter to be 1, so it is excellent results. Here you can see results of, obtained in the laboratory Omega EP. It is a laser system which generates picosecond laser pulses. In this case, this coefficient is a little bit lower, and lowest is in the case of our laser system. It is here is one reason which is responsible for these effects. It is the long laser pulse. When it is the real laser intensity of our pulse system, the peak intensity is at 10 to 12 or 1 terawatt, and you can see that 400 picosecond in front before this maximum, the intensity is about 10 to 10, and this intensity is so high, then the target is ablated, plasma is generated, electrons are escaping from the plasma, and the main part of the laser intensity interacts with this cloud of electrons, and it causes nonlinear effects like self-focusing. And we believe that with the use of excellent method yesterday presented by Professor Pisarczyk, it is femtosecond interferometry, which allowed us to observe the distribution, space distribution of electrons in front of the target in various times during the laser target interaction. So here is the interferogram transferred into the electron density, and in this here is the time evolution. Zero means that it is in the moment when the maximum laser intensity is on the target, and here 121 picosecond before this maximum we can see here that the electrons have a shape of a sphere, but with very low, very narrow jets of electrons, which expands against the laser pulse, and 179 nanoseconds after the maximum. Here we can observe a maximum of in the no, electron density, which is about 400 micrometers in front of the target. So, and as time increases, this effect is also annihilating. And this maximum can be interpreted as a result of self-focusing of the laser pulse within the electron field. And here is focus and defocus and focus. We have also other pictures where we have three, four maxima in front of the in the electron density in front of the target. And because we can generate protons with maximum energy up to 5 mega electrons, we can see from this cross section of the various fusions in the on the dependence of the projectile energy, that when we generate this 5 megaelectron volt, for example, deuterons, we are just in the maximum of the cross section of the DD fusion. So we put onto the target holder a foil of from deuterated polyethylene and offset emission of neutrons with the use of scintillation detector, and to obtain the dose, we use calibrated bubble detectors. So here it is a scheme. Laser beam was focused onto the target, and we observe the fusion within the target. Also, we perform other experiment when we use secondary targets from deuterated polyethylene or eventually from lithium fluoride, which is in fact material used for the personal dosimetry, and we observe the plasma beam fusion on secondary targets. So it is a picture of our scintillation detector. It has plastic scintillation BC408 and very fast photomultiplier. And everything is put into a Faraday cage to protect this detector against EMP, which is electromagnetic pulse, which is produced by a huge current coming from the ground to the target. And this target holder acts as emitting antenna, and it is source of electromagnetic pulses and our troubles with detection of other particles. So when we put a scintillation detector at the distance of 235 centimeters from the target, because the time of flight of DD neutrons is just 100 nanosecond. And these records helped us to analyze the energy spectra of emitted neutrons. And these bubble detectors were very useful because they allowed us to estimate the neutron yield. And here it is about 100 shots, and you can see large fluctuations from practically zero up to 2 × 10^8 neutrons per shot. This fluctuation is given by the nonlinear interaction of the laser pulse with electrons escaping the plasma. So this diagrams shows where our pulse fusion is. So it is evident that it's on this baseline, which is ended here by experiment performed at a Russian old laser system Iskra 5. It was a laser system which was built up in the old Soviet system in Arzama 16. And now this laboratory is in the has name Sarov, and it is also iodine laser system. It is the same system as our PALS laser system. It is reason why we can compare both these results, but the energy was very high, not 600 or 700 joules, by 10 kilojoules. So going back into our chamber, when we put into the chamber a holder with a deuterated target, we observe the beam, plasma beam fusion effects. And it enhances the neutron yield up to level of the Iskra 5 yield. It means that really there is no thermal fusion reactions, but reactions due to plasma beam fusion. This experiment also allowed us to estimate the number of deuterons being able to generate fusion neutrons in the target and outside the target. It means that 20% of deuterons, only 20%, produced fusion neutrons within the target bulk, and 80% of deuterons having suitable energy for the fusion were emitted or escaped the plasma and were lost. But using the secondary target, we are able to enhance the fusion, the yield of neutrons up to 10 to 9. When we substituted this deuterated target, the secondary target, with this lithium fluoride, we really observed the fast neutrons with energy about 15 mega electron volts, which were emitted by this target. Here is a formula published by Petrov and his colleagues, which shows the dependence of the neutrons from the secondary target on the energy of impacted deuterons and angle of observation. It is very important that here is no isotropic emission of neutrons, but it is strongly dependent on angle of observation. In this case, the energy yield from this fusion is 15 mega electron volts. So it is a detail of all the signals from all our five scintillation detectors, and you can see that the peak of this neutrons strongly depends on the angle of observation. And here is the time of light spectrum of neutrons, which were generated during the laser plasma interaction. And it is composed of a number of beams of deuterons, starting with energy of 2 mega electron volts up to 200 kilo electron volts. And when we compare via the time of light of deuterons from the target, primary target, to the secondary target, we obtain the dependence of the neutron energy on the energy of neutrons on the energy of deuterons into all direction, and the lowest energy of neutrons we observe about nearly 13 mega electron volts, and the highest energy was higher than 16 mega electron volts. But I would like to mention or describe shortly the last experiment performed in our laboratory. It was experiment when we irradiated a target which contained boron 11 and protons. So this fusion reaction was described in 1930, and it is known that it results in generation of three alpha particles and energy of 8.7 mega electron volts. In fact, it is a neutronic fusion. It is fusion without neutrons and very, very fine. But problem is how to detect these alpha particles. First experiment devoted to this fusion was performed by Belyaev in 2005, and they observed only, no, it is a question if it is only 1,000 alpha particles per steradian. Later, 6 years ago, Laban from France observed 10 to 7 alpha particles per steradian, but it was a pure plasma beam experiment. And my colleagues, and also me, Antonio Picciotto and Margarone, we performed experiment in 2014, and we observed 10 to 9 alpha particles per steradian. The trick was in the target. It was a single crystal of silicon, which was filled with hydrogen and boron 11, and irradiated with our laser pulse. And alpha particles were observed mainly with semiconductor ion detectors. And here you can see the time of flight signal. The blue lines, blue curve shows the signal when only a pure silicon target was irradiated. And this orange shows the time of flight signal when boron and protons generated alpha particles. So this fusion reactions is very useful for us because peak kinetic energy of protons is 600 kiloelectron volts, and it is no problem to generate with the use of our laser system. And if the interaction of the laser pulse with plasma will be improved by avoiding the relativistic self-focusing, then we could reach a ratio of the protons accelerated into the target and outside to be 50-50, then this yield could be very high. This picture shows how it is when the fusion, the neutron yields depend on the contrast of the laser pulse. When laser system Vulcan was built up, so in year 1998, they observed with energy of 20 joule, that's a very high yield, which is comparable with kilojoule laser system, like as Omega. But when they increase the bulk of Vulcan energy up to by factor of 40, up to energy of 400 joule, they observed lower neutron gain, neutron yield. It was because of this low contrast, or it depends on the contrast, which resulted into the generation of pre-plasma, and finally this picosecond laser pulse was operated as a nanosecond laser pulse. So under the conditions, it will be possible to use this fusion of protons and boron to be a source of fusion energy, which could be transformed into the electrical energy directly. So thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you. Question, please.
Yes, in the graphs that you showed of the scaling of the fusion output with the laser energy yield, what was the slope of that line?
It is the line which identifies that. Yield is in practically in every case higher, is above the baseline. And it is related to the nanosecond laser pulses, which are well focused onto the target. And if this interaction is more effective, the generation of laser plasma beams is more effective. And from this reason, the fusion is also more effective.
But what I meant was, in terms of that line, the neutron yield as a function of energy, is the neutron yield approximately proportional to the square of the input energy?
Yes.
I see.
Yes.
Okay.
But a hidden parameter here is the contrast of the laser pulse.
Right. Thank you.